Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. The pathology practical which we are going to discuss today is about cellular adaptations. Cells may adapt by undergoing changes in size, number and type. These changes occur singly or in combination. Normal cellular adaptation occurs in response to an appropriate stimulus and ceases once the need for adaptation has ceased. Cellular adaptations to injury. There are five cellular adaptations to injury: atrophy, hypertrophy, hyperplasia, metaplasia and dysplasia. Atrophy is the decrease in cell size and hypertrophy is the increase in cell size. Hyperplasia is an increase in cell number. Metaplasia is the conversion of one cell type to another, and dysplasia is disorderly growth. What is atrophy? Atrophy is the decrease in cell size due to decrease in workload or stimulus. Change is adaptive and reversible. The causes are disuse, denervation, loss of endocrine stimulation, inadequate nutrition, ischemia or decreased blood flow. The types are physiological and they include the seen in thymus and in uterus after parturition. And pathological atrophies include denervation atrophy, which is a form of disuse atrophy that occurs in the muscles of paralyzed limb, and disuse atrophy seen in reduction in skeletal muscles, use seen in muscles of the extremity that have been encased in plaster cast, and ischemic atrophy as seen in kidney, heart and other organs due to decrease in blood flow. There is lack of endocrine stimulation seen in vagina, endometrium and breast after menopause, and there is malnutrition atrophy seen in starvation. Now grossly the atrophy. Here you can see a gross picture of a heart. The affected organ is decreased in size. It appears soft, flabby. The color is pale. The capsule is wrinkled. Microscopically, the cells in atrophic organs are smaller in size and there is increase in space between the muscle fibers. Now let's move on to hypertrophy. Hypertrophy is an increase in cell size with an increase in the amount of functioning tissue mass. The types include physiological. There is increase in the muscle mass. This is associated with exercise. And in pathological, it can be adapted and compensatory. Adaptive hypertrophy, there is thickening. Example includes there is thickening of the urinary bladder from long continued obstruction of the urinary outflow. Then there is myocardial hypertrophy that results from valvular heart disease or hypertension. Then there is compensatory hypertrophy. There is enlargement of a remaining organ or tissue after a portion has been surgically removed. The gross features. Hypertrophy is characteristically asymmetrical with disproportionate septal thickening, particularly at the confluence of the anterior septum and the anterior wall. As you can see in the diagram, this is there is hypertrophy, enlargement of the cardiac muscle in response to a valve disease. This is the normal heart. This is the hypertrophied left ventricle. Microscopic features. Here you can see the normal heart muscle, and in hypertrophy heart muscle, the cardiomyocytes are hypertrophied with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and box-shaped nuclei. Myocytes display bizarre forms with Y-shaped branching, frequent side-to-side junctions, or a characteristic whorled appearance, usually around the central fibrous core. Myocardial architecture is disorganized with bundles of cardiomyocytes arranged at perpendicular and oblique angles to each other, called myocardial disarray. Now let's move on to hyperplasia. Hyperplasia is an increase in the number of cells in an organ or tissue. It occurs in tissues with cells that are capable of mitotic division, such as the epidermis, intestinal epithelium and glandular tissue. The types include physiological, seen in the breast and uterus during pregnancy, and pathological as endometrial hyperplasia and benign prostatic hyperplasia, and hyperplasia seen in the skin warts. The gross features of hyperplasia. This is a case of endometrial hyperplasia. The grossly, you can see there is an increase in the tissue size resulting from increase in the estrogen. Microscopically, there are irregular dilated glands with larger lumens. This is the key feature. Variation in gland size, nuclear atypia, nuclear size variation, nuclear cell rounding, nucleus lacking nuclei lacking atypical uniform columnar nuclei and hyperchromasia. Now let's discuss metaplasia. Metaplasia represents a reversible change in which one adult cell type is replaced by another cell type. It is reversible on withdrawal of stimulus. Examples of metaplasia is the adaptive substitution of stratified squamous epithelium of the ciliated columnar epithelium in the trachea and large airways of a habitual cigarette smoker. Then there is Barrett's esophagus. It is a pre-malignant condition that occurs in the esophagus of people with chronic esophageal reflux disease GERD. It is characterized by normal squamous epithelium in the lower esophagus, which is transformed into columnar light epithelium. The types of metaplasia. Metaplasia can be epithelial, mesenchymal epithelial seen in bronchial, gastric and cervical epithelium, mesenchymal in fractured bones. Metaplasia result in loss of some function. Persistent stimulation leads to dysplasia, which may result in carcinoma. Examples of epithelial metaplasia: the columnar is changed to the squamous metaplasia, and respiratory epithelium, as in habitual smokers and vitamin A deficiency in the cervix. Excretory ducts of salivary glands, pancreas and bile ducts. Then there is change of squamous to columnar seen in Barrett's esophagus. Connective tissue metaplasia, this formation of cartilage, bone or adipose tissue in those areas that do not contain them. Example, myositis, ossificans after intramuscular hemorrhage, bone fracture. The gross features of metaplasia. Here you can see the Barrett's metaplasia. These are the gross features. Barrett's mucosa is usually represented by well-defined areas of salmon ring velvety mucosa. Similar to the adjacent gastric mucosa, it has irregular margins and may contain islands of red residue, squamous, pearly white esophageal mucosa, or may be ulcerated. It is usually limited to the lower third of the esophagus, but in the severe cases, it may extend to the middle and upper esophagus. The microscopic features. There is, you can see metaplastic transformation of the esophageal stratified squamous epithelium on the left side to mature columnar epithelium, so-called Barrett's metaplasia. Two goblet cells can be seen, rounded shape, clear to bluish, cytoplasmic mucin, randomly scattered mucin, usually indents the nucleus. Dysplasia. Dysplasia is characterized by deranged cell growth of a specific tissue that results in cells that vary in size, shape and organization. It is potentially reversible after the irritating cause has been removed, and dysplasia is strongly implicated as a precursor of cancer. The gross features of dysplasia, you can see here dysplasia occurring in lungs. In early stages, the lungs are firm, heavy, dark red and congested. In later stages, they are firm, tanned lungs and the pleural nodularity can be seen. Microscopic features, you can see there is pleomorphism of both cells and nuclei and increase in nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, hyperchromatic or vesicular nuclei with prominence of nucleoli, increased especially presence of atypical mitotic figures, loss of polarity and intact basement membrane. Let's discuss about anaplasia. In anaplasia, the cells differentiate to a more immature or embryonic form. Malignant tumors are characterized by anaplastic cell growth. Microscopically, here you can see in anaplasia pleomorphism, there is variation in size and shape of cells at the nuclei, hyperchromatic nucleoli and coarse chromatin, there is loss of polarity. Now you have to draw these diagrams in your practical notebooks and you have to write two microscopic identification points. Here you can see skeletal muscle hypertrophy. There is hypertrophy of the muscles. Then you can see hyperplasia of prostate. This is the figure of benign prostatic hyperplasia, hyperplastic glands, variable size glands with papillary infoldings, glands lined by double layered epithelium, inner columbar and outer cuboidal, corpora malacia and fibromuscular stroma. Here you can see the diagram of showing metaplasia in the respiratory epithelium. The squamous metaplasia can be seen in the change of the columnar epithelium to stratified squamous epithelium. Here you can see the diagram showing mild dysplasia. This is a hyperkeratinized epithelium. Then there is nuclear hyperchromatism. There is connective tissue with inflammatory cell infiltration, and then there is basal cell hyperplasia. Thank you.